Berks Opera Company is a regional company committed to finding current cultural relevance in standard opera repertoire. We presently offer young artist programs for local singers and feature internationally acclaimed artists in main stage productions, presenting opera on a sustainable basis. Additionally, we have an innovative boot camp orchestra training program, the Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan multimedia educational series, and regular appearances at smaller venues in Berks County. Visit us at berksopera.org.
Good afternoon and good evening. I'm Dave Ritchie, president of Berks Opera Company and the head of our education and outreach group. Our goal at Berks Opera Company is to bring our audience closer to the wonderful art of opera, not only through our performances, but through educating and entertaining our audience. Let's just say what they used to say about wine. The more you know, the better it tastes. Well, the more you know about opera, the more you'll enjoy it. My guest is Ms. Laurice Kennel, a very talented soprano who sang with Berks Opera in our production of Carmen a few years ago, and I'm delighted to say we'll be singing on our next two Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan presentations. Those will be at 7 o'clock p.m., Tuesday, January 28th at Phoebe Berks, and 7 p.m. on Wednesday, March 11th at the Highlands. So I'm going to launch right into our discussion because Laurice is an exceptionally interesting person, and we have a lot of interesting things to talk about today. Laurice, where are you from?
I am from Niles, Michigan.
Now, where is that?
It is on the corner of Lake Michigan, which is about 12 miles away from Notre Dame, and we like to call it Michiana.
Okay, cool, cool.
So I'm closer to Chicago than I am to Detroit.
Okay, so as you're a soprano, obviously, as I've said, so let's talk about your first experience with music. What did you have in for music growing up in your household?
Well, I like to tell the story that my mom always preferred, I was a very cryy child, I'll just put it that way, I cried all the time. And so I was either crying or singing.
Oh.
And I always said my mom had a preference for one. So I always just made music as a child. And so I did grow up in a family that had music as a part of it. I grew up in a very religious family. I grew up in a religion called Seventh-day Adventist. And so I took piano lessons terribly, as I was not a great pianist as a child, and I always sang.
So what did you sing as a little child?
Mostly hymns.
Mm-hmm.
The first opportunity I had to sing a solo was from All Things Bright and Beautiful, and I got to sing one of the verses,
which was
always very, very nice.
Which verse did you sing?
He gave us eyes to see them and lips that we could tell.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. So did anyone else in your family sing?
Yes, all of my siblings sang.
Did you have a piano or an instrument in the house?
Yes, we had a piano. Mm-hmm. I also had a unique family situation that it was a blended family. And there's an 18-year age gap between myself and my older siblings.
Mm-hmm.
So my two brothers and oldest sister all sang together, and my brother continues to have like a quartet and leads music at the church.
Nice.
And then I have a closer sibling who's 3 years older than me, Lynette, and so she was always like my competition. She always played the piano better. She always sang better. She's my older sister. She's my closest older sister.
Okay.
And so she was always my musical impetus. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So yes, and then we sang together, of course, in church.
Sure. And you sang in school, I presume?
I went to a very small school, but yes, we had music classes.
Great, great. So did you learn
an instrument? Three-room schoolhouse. Other than piano, not really.
Cool. So when did you first hear opera being sung? And was it different from what you're used to hearing? Or was it, I like this, it's similar, familiar?
I lived in a town that also housed a university.
Mm-hmm.
So I grew up in Niles, and then there's a sister town called Berrien Springs, which has a large Adventist university. It's Andrews University. And so they have a good music department, and then they also would have very high church. So we had an organist who played lovely, and all of the music was classically oriented.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my father's preference as well, because we had an African-American Seventh-day Adventist church in our area, and then we also had what we would call the white church, which was the one at the university. Mm-hmm. And so that was a lot of my exposure.
So they were both Adventist churches?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And so I grew up with How Lovely Are Thy Dwellings by Lytle. I grew up with lots of, I call it 1950s church music, which is operatic, but not necessarily opera.
Sung in a classical style?
Yes.
Gotcha. Okay.
And so that was like my exposure to it. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes they would bring in classical musicians for performance opportunities. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure who I heard sing opera, mm-hmm. but it sparked something in me. I don't want to misremember. Mm-hmm. And so I went and I bought a cassette tape, which dates me, and it was Leontine Price singing Madame Butterfly. And I wore that tape out.
Oh, so you started with the best.
Yeah.
Neat. So the hearing that operatic sound was not new to you.
No, but it just
it was
touched
familiar.
Me.
Yeah.
Yes.
Cool.
Yes.
Cool. So is that was did Leontine Price make you want to sing opera like you do?
I wouldn't say that was what it was, but the voice itself always lended itself to opera. Mm-hmm. It's always been a big voice. I never had like a period where it was a smaller voice and then I grew into being a more dramatic sound.
I can attest to that. Laurice has a great, big, beautiful voice.
And so music theater never really suited. I didn't grow up in a gospel tradition, so that was never a choice. I listened to a wide variety of music, mm-hmm. from country music to pop music to opera and classical music. But I think the music and the characters, I just love a sympathetic character. Mm-hmm. I love Butterfly, I love Traviata, I love Mimi, my husband doesn't, but I do. And he likes Musetta, she's got more fire. I just love that aspect of it. Mm-hmm. And then having the music to go with it is just wonderful.
So you're not as fond of the villainesses in the operas?
I say now in my life, I think it would be a stitch to do. Uh-huh. But when I was growing up, I always identified with, you know, that tragic heroine.
Okay. So what was the first opera piece you ever learned?
It was in college, and I think it was Porgy Amore. It was my first aria.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, because they always kind of start you with leader first, mm-hmm. and so those 24 Italian songs, probably one of those would fall in that category, but
right.
Porgy Amore was my first.
Okay, so now let's talk about college. Where did you do your college and your grad school?
So, I went to Michigan State, so go Spartans, and for my undergrad, and I studied with Clarissa Bugs, mm-hmm. and then I went to University of Colorado at Boulder campus, and mm-hmm. there I studied with Dr. Patty Peterson. But I really didn't find someone.
Is that Patty Hay Peterson?
Yes, it is.
My wife knows her.
Yes. Yes, yes. So she's a wonderful technician.
Mm-hmm. Super.
And pianist.
Okay.
But I really didn't find my footing until we moved into this area. And then I started studying with Dr. Sharon Sweet.
Oh, okay.
And she just opened up the voice and made it interesting, because it always had a big voice, mm-hmm. but she also has a large voice herself.
Yes.
And then she gave me a palette of colors to use.
Great.
And that's lovely.
Super. So did you do full operas in grad school?
They did, but I wasn't always cast, mm-hmm. put it that way. I was Venus in one opera. Courses, Legisto, I believe. Uh-huh. So that was also an obscure opera to start with, mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm. And then a lot of the time I was a tech, so I ran super titles and did things like that. So, mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So as we know, the Metropolitan Opera is coming up on its second productions of Porgy and Bess. The first ones came a number of years ago. What's your experience with Porgy and Bess? Let's talk about Porgy and Bess.
It was probably, my senior year is when I was exposed to, my senior year in high school. I learned Summertime, mm-hmm. and that was the first time I sang a piece from Porgy and Bess. And actually, I've continued to sing it pretty much ever since. Mm-hmm. And then it's kind of a challenge because you don't, as an African-American singer, you don't only want to be known by singing Porgy and Bess, even though it's a catalyst for a lot of careers. Mm-hmm. So I opted not to sing it for a while. I didn't really sing it until I moved here, and I got to do a production. I sang chorus with Opera Philadelphia, and then I sang The Strawberry Woman and sang in the co-role of Lily with Opera Delaware. Mm-hmm. And I think those are the two main sources of, like professional performances. Mm-hmm. And then I've done scenes and almost all the other things from there.
Sure, sure. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about you and your relation. I could tell from talking with you beforehand, you're very fond of Porgy and Bess.
I am. It's lovely.
And as we know, Porgy and Bess, they keep talking about Porgy and Bess has been controversial since it was premiered. Mm-hmm. There were controversies about Porgy and Bess. Intellectuals like Langston Hughes, James Baldwin, agreed and disagreed about it. Langston Hughes thought it was very, very admirable. James Baldwin liked the opera, but still thought it was a white man's version of black life, in a sense. How do you react to those thoughts?
I would say that it's true. Mm-hmm. But I also would say if it wasn't captured and it didn't exist, we wouldn't have the opportunity to sing the lovely role. And I think sometimes that is the challenge with art, because oftentimes we embody characters that we actually have no relationship to other than the music. Mm-hmm. I had the opportunity to sing the role of Butterfly. And here I am, African-American, not Italian, not Japanese, not small. I'm rather tall. I'm 5'8". But the music is what allows the story to live. And so from my perspective, it allows those characters and that snapshot of time to exist. And if we didn't have that vehicle, those stories of those people, we would never be able to identify with or have it be told. Mm-hmm. And I think of that with a lot of music. If we don't perform it, it dies. If it stays on the shelf, if it stays in a book, then by being the artist or the singer, that's what breathes life into the work. Mm-hmm. And so Porgy and Bess is flawed because it's in its time, and it's perhaps not written by an African-American composer, but it's a lovely work. Mm-hmm. And there are many careers made by this work existing, and it also opened the doors for other things like Margaret Garner and Amistad to exist.
Yeah, what are just tell our audience a little bit, what are Margaret Garner and Amistad?
I can tell you the most about Margaret Garner. Margaret Garner is based on the book Beloved by Toni Morrison, and it is, the music was written by Richard Daniel Poor, who has ties to Philadelphia as well. And I think it was done in conjunction with Opera Philadelphia and I believe Detroit Opera Theater.
Mm-hmm. I saw the production in Philadelphia.
Yes. And so I got to participate in the production with New York City Opera Company. They did the production there. Mm-hmm. And I got to sing one of the smaller roles.
Cool.
But it's a huge cast.
It is
because
big.
We have a. I'm going to jump a little bit, and sure. I apologize. But that was very interesting because you had a white cast, a white chorus, and you had a black chorus, and we had different dressing rooms because we participated in different parts. It was two full choruses that made up the stage production.
It was two communities as characters, I suppose.
Yes, that would be the best way to put that. And of course the story itself is controversial, but it was lovely. And I hope that with her passing, maybe they will bring it back in honor of her. It is a lovely production.
Mm-hmm. How about Amistad?
That was produced in the late 90s, early 2000s, and it's a story of an African slave.
Okay.
And that was produced, I know, at least it was produced in Chicago.
It's been a movie too, hasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, yeah, back to Porgy. It's interesting the way you describe that because it's almost amazing, and there's not that many pieces there are not that many pieces of what you might call, some people talk about cultural appropriation, which is where one person who's not from a certain ethnic group or group exploits the culture, exploits the experiences of the other group. And in a sense that Gershwin and his writers, I mean, the people that created Porgy and Bess, DuBose Hayward wrote the book, his wife wrote a play on it, Gershwin saw the play and said that would make a great opera. The Metropolitan Opera wanted Gershwin to write an opera for them.
Okay.
And they discussed doing Porgy and Bess, but Gershwin refused to have any cast in blackface, and the Metropolitan Opera said they could not do that. They would have to have, their excuse was it would be too expensive and complicated to have a whole black cast coming in. I'm sure that the real motivation was simply racism at the time. They just weren't ready for that. Mm-hmm. And so Gershwin and DuBose Hayward, the writer, produced the show on Broadway. And it's been, as I said, it's been controversial ever since. Mm-hmm. Gershwin wrote his own spirituals and folk songs for it because he wanted the music to be all of a piece. If he had taken spirituals and folk songs from other sources, it wouldn't have been as unified. But I think everyone loves the music in Porgy. Mm-hmm. And the story is, I think in a sense, it's very universal. It's you know, people have said it portrays stereotypes of black life in a negative way. My argument would be all operas portray stereotypical characters. Yes. I mean, in every single opera, you have people getting jealous and committing murders. Mm-hmm. You have villains, you have non-villains, you have victims, you have perpetrators. So in that sense, Porgy and Bess is very much an ordinary opera story, I suppose. It's simply where he set it in Charleston was that location. Interestingly, one of the singers in the Met's production is Golda Schultz, who's from South Africa. Okay. And she talks about how her life in the South African townships, she said this was just like Charleston, you know, the communities and how the people lived. So are you looking forward to seeing the Porgy and Bess, I trust?
Yes. Great. I'm taking a friend and we're going to go to the Met and watch it.
Okay, do you have any favorite singers that are singing in it?
Angel Blue, she's definitely up and coming, and Denise Graves, and Karen Slack, who is stepping in for the productions that we're seeing.
Which character is she playing?
I want to say she's Serena, but okay. I don't want to misquote that.
Does Serena get to sing Summertime, or does she do...
My Man's Gone Now.
My Man's Gone Now, okay.
Clara is Summertime.
Yeah, I was... And they've talked about whether Porgy and Bess is... Do you think Porgy and Bess is a musical or an opera?
That's a loaded question. I think it's an opera.
All right.
It's an opera.
We agree. We're an opera program, so we think Porgy and Bess is an opera.
Yes.
I was listening to Leontine Price singing My Man's Gone Now just yesterday, and I thought to myself... This has to be done as an opera. That piece just, you need an opera singer to do it justice. And, you know, the singers today have a lot. Leontine Price set the bar pretty darn high for today's singer of any kind.
Yes.
So, tell me about what some of your friends think of Porgy and Bess.
It's the same thing. It's duplicitous. It's you want to be known as a singer first, and you want to sing the standard roles first and foremost. You know, you want to sing Verdi, you want to sing Puccini, you want to sing the things that are universally considered, you know, high opera. But then you always have a love for the work, and it provides so many opportunities. It allows you to see the world. If you're on a touring group of Porgy and Bess, you get to travel all over. It is oftentimes your first professional experience by singing or participating in Porgy and Bess. And it's a catalyst for a lot of my friends to be at the Met this season by singing in the chorus for Porgy and Bess, if not minor roles. But
I was looking at some statistics, and they said when Porgy and Bess was done at the Met, 1985, it was originally done. Not only did James Levine insist on doing it absolutely complete, every note, which people don't usually do, and they're not doing it now, it's cut substantially, but there were four black people in the Met chorus in 1985. Now there are six. So that's okay. Not much progress compared to the leading roles.
Right.
When they did it in 1985, only the two leading roles of Porgy and Bess were singers who had already been singing leading roles at the Met. That was Grace Bunbury and Simon Estes. Mm. Now, 7 of the 8 singers in leading roles have been careers at the Met. So there's sort of some class structure there. There's more progress and diversity made at the top of the ladder than there is for what I'm going to call the common folk in the chorus. Mm-hmm. You know, I hate to put it that way, but the stars are the stars and the chorus is the chorus. And so the, like I say, there's more progress that seems to be made at the upper echelons there. It would be interesting to ask the Met why that is so.
It would be.
So anyway, so what do you do when you're not singing?
When I'm not singing, well, for many years, I worked for a local pharmaceutical supply company, the mm-hmm. West Company, there in Exton. Mm-hmm. But more recently, I just took a job with the City of Philadelphia doing web development.
Cool. So you're a web designer.
Yeah.
Have I seen any of your web pages?
Not yet.
Not yet. Well, looking forward to.
Yeah, but I help maintain Philadelphia, which is the internal So the staff website.
So sort of the infonet for the city employees.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that sounds, you have a lot of talents. How did you get your computer expertise?
All the way through college. So when I went to Michigan State, I was a voice student, but I also was a tech in the lab. So I helped people at the help desk and answered questions about Word and things like that. And when I was in grad school, I was a singer, but then I always had to, you know, work for paying your bills and things. And then I worked at the help desk and answered people's questions. And, you know, like I said, I did tech for the operas itself because you can always find a niche, right?
Sure.
And so so that's always, they've kind of lived in parallel, thankfully. Thank you. We're paying Sally Mae off.
Yeah.
In my life. And so that's kind of cool.
So this is fascinating. I had no idea this conversation was going to go this direction. So let's go a little further.
Okay.
What are some of the stupidest questions people ever asked when you were on the help desk?
Oh, I wouldn't say that they're necessarily stupid questions because there's no stupid questions, right?
But only uninformed people.
Right. Or poor planning.
Yeah.
That if you didn't save copies of your most important document and it got erased, you know, mm-hmm. there's only so much that I can do to help you mm-hmm. and things like that. So
sure.
It's a lot of hand-holding and crying during finals week and helping people reformatting things and
got
things
it.
Like that.
So what's your strongest expertise in the computer world? Web design or... Are you a power user of Word and Excel and those things?
I would say my patience and my willingness to help.
Oh, excellent. That's always a good answer. It's a good answer.
So I'm working on the other ones. So.
Cool. So we're coming to the sort of the end of our segment. I'm just going to ask you, what are you singing for us in Burke's Opera Company in our next two shows?
Oh, the selections?
Yes.
Well, I haven't picked my music for the second one.
Okay.
I'm still doing my research. I have to say, I love doing the research to pick the mm-hmm. music that I'm going to sing. So that always takes time, is like planning for me. But for the first one, for Porgy and Bess, I will be singing He Is By, which is from the opera Margaret Garner mm-hmm. and written by Richard Daniel Poor. And it is the mother, Margaret's mother's, it's a duet, but he's excerpted as a aria. Mm-hmm. And then I'm singing The Willow Song, written by Samuel Coleridge Taylor. And you actually put me onto that one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lovely song. It is from Shakespeare. And it is the same song if you're thinking of Othello. It's the song that Desdemona references when she sings The Willow mm-hmm. Song.
Now that's very romantic. Coleridge Taylor is like 100 years ago, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And then finally, I'm singing Steal Away, arranged by Maria Thomas Corley, who is a local pianist and music arranger, and it is a spiritual.
Great.
So, but I think it'll be more challenging for Caleb than for me, but that's my fun.
Caleb's a great sight reader, but you did what you have sent him the music.
I have sent him the music.
So the responsibility is on you, Caleb, to have those pieces learned and prepared.
Yes,
so
and they're lovely.
I'm calling you, Caleb. So at this segment of the program, I'm going to provide some advertisements for our upcoming events.
Okay.
So our next presentation, Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan, featuring my guest Laurice, Tuesday, January 27th at 7 p.m., Phoebe Burke's Wernersville. Plenty of free parking. easy access for people with special needs, free admission for Phoebe residents, others $20, adults and seniors, $15 for students and young people under 30. You can pay at the door. And as another special guest, we will have Brian Gibson, who in his day performed the role of Porgy all over the world, and he will speak about the opera and his experiences. Now, coming up, the next Metropolitan Opera live and high definition broadcast at the Fox Berkshire. In the coming months, we have Saturday, February 1st, 2020 at 12:55 p.m., Porgy and Bess. Saturday, February 29th at 12:55 p.m., Agrippina, an opera by George Frederick Handel. Talk about female villains. I think that opera's got one. We will then have The Flying Dutchman, March 14th, 2020 at 12:55 p.m., and you will be singing on our presentation before that one.
Yes.
Now, you cannot see Madame Butterfly too many times in one season in too many places. So, on April 26th, Berks Opera and AAA Reading Berks will be running a trip to Opera Philadelphia's Sunday matinee production of Madame Butterfly at the Academy of Music. $219 per person includes bus, back and forth, dinner, and opera tickets. Contact the AAA for details and reservations, 610-374-5600. That's 610-374-5600. You cannot reserve by contacting Berks Opera. You must contact AAA. Other upcoming events. Most people don't think of Johann Sebastian Bach as an opera composer, but this spring, Berks Opera will be performing a delightful little comic piece at the Reading Liederkranz. Enjoy dinner, dessert, and coffee. More details coming, so watch our website at berksopera.org or email us at berksoperacompany@gmail.com. Now, looking farther into the future, in August, Berks Opera is going to present Mozart's classic, The Magic Flute, at the Miller Center for the Arts. We will feature Maggie Riker as the Queen of the Night, Kara Latham as Pamina, Fred Schlick as Tamino, and Jeremy Gallion as Zarastro, all of whom have given us absolutely wonderful performances. So, before we finish tonight, we need to thank our sponsors. Fox Theaters, where you can see the Metropolitan Opera live and high-definition opera simulcasts. Reading Music Foundation. Pennsylvania Council on the Arts. Berks Arts Council. John P. Feeney Funeral Home. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Reach out to us at berksoperacompany@gmail.com. If you send us an email, we will then know who you are and we will add you to our mailing list. We promise we will not send you unsolicited spam. We will not send you junk mail. We will send you a few things per month about our events and sometimes about events by some of our partner organizations. Support Berks Opera. Go online to berksopera.org and click on the links that says support us. You can donate online. Find our archived programs and presentations on YouTube by searching Berks Opera. Thank you very much again, and we'll see you at the opera. And thanks, Laurice. I look forward to hearing you in a few weeks.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome.